host. Thank you for accepting this interview. My first question, Chevron Romania just announced is suspending the activity in Pungești. Mm-hmm. For how long?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. One of Chevron's core operating principles is safety, and we have a motto. It's do it safely or not at all, and our number one priority is the safety of our employees, our contractors, and the citizens of the community where we are performing the operations. And we have in our company what we call stop work authority. Anytime an employee feels that there is a potential for an unsafe operation or for a member of the community or a contractor, an employee to be injured, we shut down operations. And so to answer your question, we will restart operations when, after close consultation with the government, we decide that there are safe conditions to reopen the operations. And let me say that we are here to create a long-term relationship with the community and with the country of Romania over our project life of approximately 30 years. And so we want to make sure that we inform the community and communicate to them that these operations can be done safely and in an environmentally responsible manner.
What does this exactly mean in terms of weeks, months? How much do we expect mm-hmm. this safety conditions mm-hmm. to be improved?
Once we are able to determine that safe operations can be performed and that we can do our work without harming or doing harm or anyone in the community being harmed, then yes, we will continue. And we respect the right of all people to voice their opinion. We just don't want them to put themselves in a situation where it would not be safe for them or safe for any of our employees.
Let me put it this way. If you are going to discuss a lot more with the community, mm-hmm. yeah, with the relevant stakeholders in mm-hmm. the area, but the local community is going to oppose to mm-hmm. your activity, mm-hmm. are you considering leaving for good?
Mm-hmm. I would say that when people are informed of the facts of these operations and the long period of time over which similar operations have been performed, they will come to understand and appreciate that these activities can be conducted safely and in an environmentally responsible way. And so it is important to make sure that they are equipped with the facts and then that they can judge for themselves. And so our responsibility is to make sure that those facts are put forward for their consideration. The way in which we do that are as the following. We have had town halls in Pungest. We have gone door to door and advised people and spoken with them one-on-one. And we will continue to do that. We have had delegations who have taken a trip to Poland to speak with members of the community and to witness operations. And they have come back with eyewitness accounts, which they can share with their neighbors. So this is the way in which we will communicate.
But I just saw a few days ago a piece of news that says like something like this. The community in Pungești just put a monument, a wooden cross, mm-hmm. given by a monastery mm-hmm. from Moldova, mm-hmm. to the very place you want to access mm-hmm. in order to mm-hmm. begin your works. How are you going to deal with this kind of attitude?
Mm-hmm. First of all, as I say, we respect the right of all people to voice their opinion. and to state their beliefs and to share their views. We want them to do it safely. We want their opinions to be heard, but we want it to be done in a safe manner. And regarding the placement, I would say I will leave the local and the county authorities to take the course of action, if appropriate, on where the item has been placed.
Will you change the way that you communicate, that Chevron is communicating mm-hmm. with the local community or mm-hmm. with the national public mm-hmm. after this event?
Mm-hmm. I'll comment firstly on the locality and on the community. And our experience has been that going door to door and speaking one-on-one with people and equipping them with facts and sharing with them information. What we found was very interesting, Christian, it was during the door-to-door campaign in August and September, teams visited four communities in the area, and there were over 600 households visited for engagements ranging from 20 minutes to 80 minutes. That is a long time for a good fact-based dialogue to occur. In only two households out of the 600 did people say, "I'm sorry, no, we have enough information." What that means, or what that tells me, is people want to understand and people want to receive the facts.
So, coming back to my question, mm-hmm. are you going to communicate the same locally, or are you going to change somehow mm-hmm. this communication?
We will communicate the same way that we communicated in August and September, and we will equip people with facts so that they can make a judgment and decide for themselves.
This is for the local community. Mm-hmm. What about the communication for the broader audience, mm-hmm. meaning the national audience?
Mm-hmm. Within the national audience, we also have, as you mentioned, operations in the south, in Dobruja. And let me say that our communication method has been town halls. There has been approximately 15 town halls that we have held in small communities, where we can have question and answer sessions, a presentation. We have today, for example, in a community, there is a town hall that is being held. There will be a presentation. There will be a visit by academicians who will speak on the topics of technology. And then there will be a question and answer session. And so that is the way in which we believe that we can most effectively communicate with people. And our experience has been, yes, we need to work in communities, and we will continue to focus our work in the communities.
Speaking about communication, what did you communicate with the Prime Minister, mm-hmm. Mr. Victor Ponta, in mm-hmm. Washington? What did you mm-hmm. ask him, and what mm-hmm. did he tell you?
Sure. On the 21st of October, at a business roundtable, there were 14 companies who are interested in investing in Romania. Chevron, of course, is one of those. Chevron was represented by a local vice president in the Pennsylvania region. And I would say the following. There is a mutual intention of both parties to establish a long-term economic partnership with bilateral benefits, and which could enhance Romania's energy security and economic development. And Chevron intends to respect its commitments to operate in full compliance with Romanian legislation, with EU norms, and also the best practices of the oil and gas industry.
We are going to come back to that discussion about the benefits for the local and national economy a little bit later. Now I would go back to the community, and we saw in Punjești and in the broader Bastui area that a leading role in the protests against shale gas related activities was taken by priests and monks from the area. What are you going to do about that? Because I'm asking you this because in Romania, all over the world, but in that area especially, the priests are very important for the community.
We respect the right of people to express their viewpoint. Our role, and I will focus, Christian, on the role that Chevron can play in this dialogue. Our role is to make sure that people are equipped with the facts and to make sure that the discussion is vigorous, that it is fact-based, and that I believe people want to understand what are the benefits for Romania. What are the benefits for my community? What are the benefits for my children? And so our communication will focus on, first of all, energy security. That is, currently Romania imports approximately 30% of its natural gas. The remaining 70% is produced within Romania, but those gas reserves will dwindle over the next 10 to 15 years. They need to be replaced. This initiative is a potential replacement of gas that is currently being produced in Romania. So that will create energy security, and we hope that Romania will become energy independent or energy secure. What are the benefits locally? The benefits locally are jobs creation. In the communities where we work, we make sure that local suppliers are contracted. We make sure that jobs are offered to citizens of the local community. Let me be very specific. In our operations in Dobrogea, there is a crew of 150 that is working on our geophysical survey. Prospect Tune is a Romanian company. The crew of 150 are Romanian nationals from all over Romania. But in addition, there are 50 jobs that have been created specifically for people, members of the communities in that area. And that's important. We believe that jobs creation will help people. And finally, we believe that within those communities where we work, there should also be benefits, and Chevron is committed to being a good partner with the Romanian government, but also a good neighbor. And that means social investment. The types of social investment range from, in 2012, after consultation with local authorities and also the director of the health services, we donated an ambulance to the county hospital in Vaslui. In Dobrogea, we are contributing to a medical caravan that travels throughout the communities in Dobrogea, and we're also sponsoring a program that will help keep disadvantaged youth in school. So those are the ways in which we can provide local benefits, but then also social contributions that will benefit people in those communities.
And are you going to create these kind of social programs that in order to involve also the church? Because my initial question was about the role of the priests and the monks in those protests. Are you thinking about involving them into these kind of social initiatives?
We welcome benefits for all members of the community, and we respect the special role that is played by priests. And so, yes, we will work with all members of the community to identify needs And the needs that we have seen in communities generally focus on two things. One, improvement of road conditions. And the second is people generally want a community water well, a well that is drilled to a deeper depth that has access to a layer of water that is 100 or 200 meters below the surface, as opposed to a shallow water well in their backyard. Those are the types of needs where we want to work with community leaders.
I know from the experience of Pennsylvania, the Marcellus shale gas exploration, that there are a lot of advantages taken by the local community, the fact that the services are expanding, are improving, the, mm-hmm. the jobs creation and so on. But it seems that there are people here in Romania, or forces here in Romania, who are not in favor of, mm-hmm. of this, mm-hmm. of what you mm-hmm. Said. And I remember that the president and the prime minister of Romania saying repeatedly that the Russian Federation or some big Russian Russian companies had an interest to in stopping Chevron from exploring shale gas mm-hmm. in Romania. Do you have some evidence in this regard? Mm-hmm.
I have no evidence of geopolitical strategies that are at work here in Romania, but I do know this. What I can do, or what Chevron can do and should do, is communicate effectively so that people can make their own decisions and determine their own future, and they must see the benefits. They must see the benefits of these activities before they are convinced. I respect that.
So I want to talk a bit about the exploration phase.
Yes.
With you. What technology are you going to use? Is fracking involved? Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. There are phases within exploration. The objective of the exploration phase is to determine what the gas reserves or the volume of gas is. And that takes approximately 3 to 5 years. And it is followed then by a period of approximately 30 years of development or exploitation. So this exploration phase is very important. The first phase is a geophysical survey. The objective of the geophysical survey is to image the rock layers, and we are interested in determining the characteristics and quality of the rock. And in particular, we are interested in a layer of rock that is called shale. It is a very dense rock. It is, we are interested in determining what the properties of this rock are. And the geophysical survey phase will tell us where the thickest section of shale is. After the geophysical survey, there will be a period of exploration drilling, which is to take a sample of rock that is shale and to test the properties of this shale rock to determine if there is gas inside. Chevron has permits for this exploration drilling phase, exploring in vertical wells to take samples of rock. That is fully permitted. The next and last phase in the exploration period is a pilot project where we will take a vertical well and then drill horizontally through approximately 1 kilometer of shale rock. And we will use also hydraulic fracturing, which creates a small fissures that open up the rock and allow gas to flow into the well bore and then to the surface. Chevron has not reached the pilot project stage. We do not have permits to hydraulically fracture or to horizontally drill. our permits at this early phase are for conventional drilling.
So let me repeat in order to see if I fully understood what you said. There are three phases of the
exploration
mm-hmm. phase. In the last one, Chevron may drill vertically, then horizontally, and then use fracking. Mm-hmm. This is the last phase.
That is the last phase,
and you need a special permit for doing horizontal drilling and mm-hmm. using hydraulic fracturing. Mm-hmm. Fracturing that you don't have yet.
We do not for every well. We will require a permit. We will work with the authorities to obtain permits, but no, our permits right now are for conventional drilling that does not involve hydraulic fracturing or horizontal drilling.
Normally, if Chevron is going to start the first phase mm-hmm. of the exploration activity, mm-hmm. in how long is going to enter the third phase?
Mm-hmm.
1 year, 2 years?
Yeah,
years?
It will probably be 2 to 3 years. We will want to have the results of multiple wells that have been drilled vertically to take rock samples and to determine is there the potential for gas. And then once there is the potential for gas, the way we understand if the flows are economic to justify a project that is economically viable, we will do a pilot project.
One of the concerns of the public regarding the hydraulic fracturing mm-hmm. is the earthquakes. Mm-hmm. Did Chevron do tests and analyzes to ensure that the fracking is not going to be done mm-hmm. over seismic lines, seismic faults?
Sure. The objective of the geophysical survey is to determine where those faults lie. And where there is a fault, Chevron and every responsible oil company would avoid drilling through the faults. So let me confirm again that the first part of the exploration period, the geophysical survey, will show us where the faults are and where there is the potential for seismic activity. We would not drill through faults. And let me remind you, Chevron is a California company. California is as seismically active as Romania. It has, I believe, the world's longest fault line, the San Andreas Fault. Has that fault or the seismic activity of that area meant that companies cannot do exploration or production drilling in California? No. It's being done, and California is one of the largest producers of oil and gas in the nation.
Another matter of concern for the public is the water. Mm-hmm. Which is the estimated quantity for Romania if you are going to enter the exploitation phase?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. First, let me talk about the exploration phase. And in the exploration phase, drilling with conventional technologies, the water requirement is approximately 1,500 cubic meters. As an example, an irrigation of roughly 2.5 hectares of rapeseed would require this same amount of water, just for comparison's sake. For the hydraulic fracturing stage, which occurs only once, that is, a well is hydraulically fractured once at the beginning, and over the life of the production period, 30 years, there is no further water requirements to hydraulically fracture. The water volume for the hydraulic fracturing stage ranges from 10,000 to 20,000 cubic meters of water through the lifetime of the well. This is equivalent to about 4 to 8 Olympic-sized swimming pools. And while this is a substantial quantity of water, it's low in comparison to the overall water usage in local areas. And so it is low by comparison to conventional drilling over the life of a well, or low by comparison to other industrial activities such as production of coal or nuclear.
Which are the sources for the water, let's say in Vaslui area?
Sure. In one of the permits that is required from the local authorities is a water permit, and so Chevron has worked with the local water authority to identify the sources of water, whether it be a river or whether it be underground sources, or the water authority may require that we truck in water from a distant location. That is the prerogative of the water authority and the permit that they grant to us.
If you start producing gas, what is going to happen with the water that comes back to the surface in the production process, the so-called reflux fluid?
Yeah, that it is recycled and used in other drilling activities, and so the actual water requirement for the entire project is decreased by reusing, recycling the water that is used in the initial hydraulic fractures.
I saw on your website here in Romania that one solution for this reflux fluid is building artificial lakes at the surface if the quantity of the water is that big.
Yeah.
Do you take into consideration this solution for Romania?
It would, in our operations, there is a drilling rig, and then off to one side, there is a lined pool that is used to store water. And this water is used and recycled in other operations. So at the conclusion of the drilling activities, the site, the entire site, is restored. And there is a very, very small footprint with a few gas pipelines. And the rest of the area is returned to its original use, which is usually for agriculture.
So there is not going to be a pool or an artificial lake after you finish the
No.
It, activities?
The objective is to restore as much of the area to its original use.
Let's talk a little bit about the fluid that you're using during the fracking. I found on your website a list of the chemical in this process, and it says on that list that is used typically in the process. Is Chevron Romania going to use the same chemicals that I saw here, or are there going to be any changes to this list?
Chevron will voluntarily publish the composition of the hydraulic fracturing fluid. So this is a 1 liter sample of the hydraulic fracturing fluid. It will be 99.5% water and sand. The sand is used to hold open the small fissures. People are very interested to know what are the other four additives, and I can explain what those are. One additive is a guarum gum, which will hold a sand molecule in place and deposit it in the small fissure. Another is a viscosity reducer, because volumes of water are being ejected down a well bore, and this viscosity reducer allows flow rates to increase to generate the necessary pressure to fracture rock. Also, there is a antibactericide that prevents the formation of any type of thing, that any substance that would reduce the flow rate. And then finally, it is important to note that all of these additives could be found in your own home. The guarum gum you could probably find in your wife's lipstick or in a milkshake at your favorite restaurant. The bacterial agent you'd probably find in your kitchen counter. But the important thing is the transparency, and Chevron is committed to disclosing the full substances that are used.
When are you going to disclose? Immediately after you get the permit, if you get the permit to produce the gas?
Yes, once we reach the stage where hydraulic fracture operations would require the use of the fluid, then yes, we would we will disclose.
Let's go a little bit to Dobrogea, to your work there. Which is the schedule for your activities there?
We have begun the geophysical survey in the middle of September. We will work with Prospect Tunney to acquire data from this geophysical survey with this crew of approximately 200 people, 50 of which are local employees. And then that activity will take approximately 8 to 9 months at this point in time. And then there will be an evaluation for potential well sites based on this data that has been received from the geophysical survey.
You told us earlier about the benefits for the economy, both locally and nationally, if you find shale gas and begin to produce it. What do you intend to do with the gas once you start the production? I mean, do you right now do you intend to sell it internally on the internal market, or do you also think about exporting it? Because in a few years' time, Romania is going to be connected to the region through pipes.
Yes. The market, the first market is Romania. And as I mentioned, 30% of the gas demand in Romania is exported at a very high price. Most of the components of that high price are pipeline transit fees. Natural gas that is produced here in Romania avoid such a long transit cost. And so the logical place is to sell the natural gas here in Romania, because we believe, price-wise, it should compete very favorably with imports. Chevron looks at the market, and you are correct in stating that we see not only Romania, but we see all of the European Union, the 28 member states of the European Union, as part of a single marketplace that is linked together with interconnecting pipelines.
And not also the 28 member states of the European Union, but also the neighbors of Romania, Republika Moldova, or Ukraine, that are now depending on, heavily dependent on imports. Can they be a potential market for Chevron?
The market will be determined wherever buyers are looking for natural gas. And we see, right now I can speak only about Romania and the demand that it has for natural gas. But will the gas be able to flow other places? Yes, and if it flows to a neighbor or to another distant country in the European Union, there will be that transit element that must be competitive with other sources. And so the natural market would be Romania.
How many jobs do you think this activity can create in Romania? Mm-hmm. Do you have an estimation or
We look, I will go back to the example of the workforce in Dobruja. There are, as I mentioned, roughly 150 to 200 employees, steady employees by Prospectun. But for each of those direct jobs, there are four or five indirect jobs that are created in the surrounding community. And let me be very clear about what those jobs might be. Those employees will need a place to stay. And in the case of Dobruja, there are two hotels in Venus, in Mongolia, that are housing the employees. Those jobs in the hotel are created because those hotels would be empty during the off season. So those jobs range from preparing meals for the employees, washing clothes, cleaning, but then also there are local shopkeepers who will benefit from the work crew going and buying goods in stores, or security detail, or drivers. And so at that point, then you realize it's not just 150 or 200 direct jobs, it's more like 1,000 jobs that are created. And in Pennsylvania, the statistics are for a mature shale gas operation are very convincing. I have seen reports that claim that over 300 to 400,000 jobs have been created in Pennsylvania, transforming that economy. And also, I should say, another benefit of natural gas from shale is a energy secure, low priced volume of energy will revitalize industries. In Pennsylvania, the industries that were revitalized were petrochemicals and steel. Those were industries that left the United States almost 40 years ago. I believe, and I believe the government feels the same way, that petrochemicals and steel here in Romania will become more internationally competitive with a secure, cheap source of natural gas.
Talking about the price, are you going to produce this gas, to produce this gas at the same costs as Romgaz or when Petrom is producing the gas right now, or other producers? Is the same price?
I cannot comment on that because I don't know their production costs. But I do know this, and this is very important for Romanian citizens. Larger supplies or larger volumes of natural gas that are produced inside of Romania will drive down prices. It will, the supply and demand situation will become such that as supply increases, prices generally will go down. And so, so far as talking about production costs, I would say the most important thing is Chevron is committed to helping the government of Romania and the citizens of Romania understand what their natural resources are. And then there should also be a consideration, should these natural resources be produced, what are the benefits, and how can Romania's economy be revitalized by these natural resources.
Talking about helping the Romanian economy, there is an ongoing discussion about the royalties and the taxes paid by the oil and gas companies in Romania. And Prime Minister Ponta recently said that he is considering a move in which a part of this money would go to the local communities, mm-hmm. Would you agree that besides the royalties that you're going to pay, mm-hmm. To pay some extra taxes or, mm-hmm. or something that is going to go directly to the local mm-hmm. community? Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I agree that the communities should see a benefit from this activity. That is clear. How much is sent from the national government to the local government? I will let the Romanian government decide that. But the principle is valid. Local communities should see a benefit from this activity. And for Chevron's part, the way in which we can bring directly a benefit to the community is through social investment that I talked about. And we are committed to doing that. It doesn't require legislation, it's not mandated, but wherever we go, wherever Chevron has operations, it is committed to working with communities to provide schools, educational opportunities, and to increase the economic progress of that community.
My last question is about the transparency. Are you thinking about, is Chevron Romania thinking about adhering to extractive industries transparency initiative? Mm-hmm. I know that Chevron is member of this mm-hmm. RPI mm-hmm. in some countries. Mm-hmm.
We believe that there should be transparency in the operations and that people should understand and be equipped with the facts. I've mentioned that, yes, we will make sure there have been questions about the composition of the hydraulic fluids. We will disclose those. We will make sure that everyone understands what they are. So far as transparency, I believe a year or a year and a half ago, there were questions about what was in the concession agreements with Chevron. In June of 2012, they were disclosed. So Chevron is a transparent company, and it believes in the value of transparency in communicating with communities and the national government.
Speaking about communities, can you tell us how much land did you already buy or rent in both Moldova and Dobrogea in order to mm-hmm. Make your activities?
Sure. I do not know the exact number of the land parcels, but I do know this. I know wherever we conduct operations, we will meet with either the renter or the owner of the land parcel and make sure that they are compensated for their alternate use of the land. Generally, it's agricultural land, and so the value of the crops that could have been produced in that land is the compensation value of the land. And we're making sure that we want to make sure that landowners are compensated fairly and justly for this activities that are conducted.
Thank you. These were my questions. If you want to add something, mm-hmm. a topic that we didn't cover, please.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, sure. I'd be happy to say the benefits for Romania are clear. I believe that there is enough evidence in other countries of the world where this activity has been performed. Delegations have gone to other areas and been able to talk with communities. Last week, for example, there was a government delegation that spent time in the Marcellus region talking with academics, talking with community leaders, and understanding benefits that can occur in small communities. Secondly, the technologies that are used. There have been concerns. I'd like to say over 1 million wells have been drilled using these technologies. There is a strong body basis for forming an opinion. The Environmental Protection Agency of the United States has declared there is no link between this technology of hydraulic fracturing and contamination of groundwater. Finally, the benefits for Romania will also be jobs creation in communities for locals that need jobs, and then also for nationally, it will make the nation energy secure and revitalize sectors of the industry that will benefit from secure and cheap supply of natural gas.
You said earlier about a governmental delegation that went to Pennsylvania. Mm-hmm. Was this delegation taken there by the Romanian state money or from your money?
No, it was Romanian state money.
Romanian state.
Yeah, it was their initiative to visit. Chevron accompanied, but it was a fact-finding visit to speak with people and to understand what could be the potential benefits for Romania and to understand technologies.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.